Okay, all right, guys. So basically, when we talk about the cost management concepts, okay, so this will be your section D, USCMA part one. Okay, when basically we will talk about the cost management concepts, so it all talks about how the managers of the company very effectively and very efficiently manage the cost of the company. Okay, just follow this red marker and just look on your screens. So, how the manager can effectively and efficiently manage their cost? Definitely by reducing the cost. But while reducing the cost, the quality, speed and efficiency must not be reduced. It must be up to the standard marks of the company or up to the benchmark conditions of the company. Okay, then only we can say a successful manager has been termed out from all of its operations of the company, and then only a manager is called as a successful cost manager of the company. Okay, so being studying the USCMA concept, so this cost management chapter has to be read into a very precise detail so that you can have a good head in your career, in your future. Okay, now let's go in detail and study about all the cost management and the measurement concepts. Okay, so now before starting up with the measurement concepts of this chapter, so let's understand about cost. What can be the various cost systems? What can be the classifications? What can be the derivatives of cost? What can be the categories of cost? What are direct material, indirect material, labor, everything? What are cost drivers? What are absorption costing? How the accounting takes place in absorption and the variable costing? How the absorption and the variable costing are the two different concepts? We'll talk in detail into this lesson. Okay, so let's start with the three kinds of cost system for a company. Look guys, so basically actual cost system, normal cost system and the standard cost system are the three kinds of cost system that are termed under the cost category of every company. Okay, now let's study in detail about these topics. Now what is actual cost system? The actual cost system is so it means the actual expenditures made to acquire an asset by the company. So whatever the actual expenditures within a year a company makes, that are that all cost comes terms under the actual cost system of the company. Okay, now what are the normal cost system of the company? Now these are the normal or the regular costs that a company incur from their day-to-day expenses or from today their day-to-day running of the business, whether it can be monthly, quarterly or yearly, but these are the normal costs of the company which they incur. Okay, so these normal costs are also known as regular costs for the company. Okay, and these normal or the regular costs basically are the costs which are termed or which are known from the normal conditions of the company. So when your company will be working on normal operations, normal efficiency, normal effectiveness, that has been benchmarked by the managers, okay, with the minimized set of errors and with the maximum work output, at that time the normal cost is termed out. Okay, and that is only the major difference between actual and the normal. Normal cost is derived out from the normal business operations of the company, and actual cost is derived out from the actual expenditures that has already been incurred within the company. Okay, so don't miss the actual and the normal cost of the company. Okay, now these are the two separate concepts. Okay, do read the definition in your book, and if you have any doubts, just comment down below or just ask me on my WhatsApp group. Okay, now let's talk about the standard costing system. Now standard costing is very easy to understand. So basically every year, every for the next year, the managers set some budgets, set some estimate. Okay, so standard costing is also known as estimated cost or the budgeted cost. Okay, so for every next year the managers set some budgets, they set some estimated cost, like for the next year the per unit raw materials cost should be around $10 per unit or $20 per unit or $30 per unit, not more. It can be more than that or it can be less than that. Okay, so that depends upon the efficiency of the business or inefficiency of the business. So that concept we'll talk on later on. A standard cost means, standard costing means the estimated cost or the budgeted cost that the manager sets for the next business, for the next upcoming business period, and on the basis of standard cost the company budgets are prepared. So if you have already read the section B, then you have a very good catch up on this chapter, this part of the topic. Okay, now let's go further. Okay, now let's talk about the overheads of the company. See, look guys, so basically in the previous slide I talk about the cost system, that is actual, normal and standard cost. And now in this presentation slide I will talk about the overheads. Now don't mix the cost system and the overheads. Now these are again the separate terms, okay, don't mix them together. So overheads are basically over the head cost, means the cost which has not been directly traced while manufacturing a product. Okay, so the cost that has not been directly traced while manufacturing a product, that cost is termed as overhead cost. Okay, it is still given to the products, it is still divided among the per units of the products, but not with the direct materials and the direct labor. They come under the separate cost category, that is the overhead cost category. Okay, what is the function of direct materials? Under direct materials, the cost is directly traced to a product, because under direct materials, raw materials comes. Okay, under the direct labor, the workers which are actually working for the number of hours for manufacturing a product, so that cost is completely given or completely contributed towards the manufacturing of a product. Okay, so direct material and direct labor, these are the direct costs that has been directly traced to a product. But what about the electricity from which the furnitures are, from which the goods are manufacturing? What about the rent that the company is paying every year? What about the insurance coverage? What about the utilities? What about the accounting department? How the salaries are given to the taxation department, accounting department? What about the office stationery? What about the repairs and maintenance? So all these are the kinds of costs which are not directly traced while manufacturing a product, but these costs incur. So in order to have a good running of business, we keep all these categories of costs under one category, that is known as overhead cost of the company. Okay, now again, you have read the three concepts, that is actual three cost systems, that is the actual cost system and the normal cost system. Okay, actual, that is same over here also, actual overhead rates and the normal overhead rates. Okay, actual overhead rates are basically the actual overheads that has already been incurred within a company, and the normal overhead rates are basically the normal overheads that has incurred when the business was in normal condition of efficiency and its operations. Okay, I repeat the term again and again, when the business is in normal operation and the normal efficiency and it's in normal conditions and effectiveness, okay, at then only time the normal overhead rates occur for the company. Okay, so I hope now this concept has been clear to you. Okay, and I don't feel like I have like tried to explain into a best easy and possible manner. And if you have any doubts, your doubts are most welcome to me. Do comment down below or do just write on my WhatsApp group chat. Okay, now let's talk about adjustments of under and over applied overheads. Okay, so now I hope like this time you have been have a cleared like views about overheads. Okay, so I hope now you have a clear description about overhead. So what does overhead means? I think now you know. Okay, overhead means over the head cost. So now let's talk about the adjustments of under and the over applied overheads. Okay, remember the term, we also talk adjustments as dispositions of the company. Okay, हम इसको डिस्पोजिशंस की हेडिंग भी देते हैं कंपनी के अंडर. तो पेपर में डिस्पोजिशन का क्वेश्चन आ जाए तो इसको कंफ्यूज मत करना, एडजस्टमेंट्स को हम डिस्पोजिशन का हेडिंग भी देंगे इसके अंदर. ओके, सो डोंट गेट कंफ्यूज इन इट. सो एडजस्टमेंट्स ऑफ अंडर एंड द ओवर अप्लाइड ओवरहेड्स ऑफ अ कंपनी. ओके, सो बेसिकली व्हेन द एक्चुअल ओवरहेड्स इनकर्ड आर लेस देन द एस्टिमेटेड ओवरहेड्स. Okay, I don't have a pen, so I'm just drawing with my mouse, so please cooperate. So when the actual overhead is less than the estimated overhead of the company, at that time the overheads are under applied overheads. Okay, when the actual overhead is less than the estimated overhead of the company. At that time we termed it as the under applied overheads, okay. But when the actual overheads that has incurred in the company are more than the estimated overheads of the company, at that time we will term it as over applied overheads, okay. It's a simple concept to understand, okay. Now how do we determine the estimated overheads? Now these estimated overheads are determined through this predetermined overhead rate formula. So this is like overhead rates, predetermined overhead rate is equal to estimated overhead cost divided by estimated activity based units, okay. So basically the managers of the company, when the budgeting committee is formed, that you have already read in your section B also. So basically when the budgeting committee is formed in your company, okay, the managers sit around the table and they will find out all the standard costs for the number of products or number of manufacturing units in the company. The standard cost is prepared, the standard budgets are prepared by the company, okay. At that time only the overhead budgets are also prepared. Those overhead budgets are known as the estimated overhead budgets also, okay, or the standard overhead budgets also. And there I don't think that there will be any confusion in it, okay. So they basically use this kind of formula only, that is predetermined overhead rate is equal to estimated overhead cost, like the cost that they have estimated, okay, for the next year of manufacturing of 5000 units of my product, $100,000 of overhead cost estimated has to be occurred, okay. So estimated overhead cost divided by estimated activity based units, it means like how much units of cost has to be manufactured at how much estimated cost. The similarly $1,000 of units of estimated cost will be divided by 5000 units. I am just letting this amount, supposing this amount, okay. So $100,000 of estimated overhead cost will be divided by 5000 units. So with this it will equal to you around the per unit overhead rate will be determined through this formula, okay. And then the same, like after the production has been done, then we can take out the under and the over applied overheads of the company, okay. And then we can measure the company accounts and we can see like whether the business is into profitable line or whether the business has incurred any losses or something, okay. Now if there are under applied overheads, so this means we are in saving of the cost, okay. So we manufactured the good quality products up to the benchmark at a low cost, so the company is in profit. But if the over applied overhead situation arises, so this means the actual cost incurred is more than the estimated cost, so we have gone more than the budget. So might be the company can go into losses if the sale has not been up to the mark for the company, okay. And then the senior managers of the company will scroll down their colleagues, they will scroll down their juniors of the company, those have prepared their budget and those have not have a good eye while manufacturing the products, okay. Then all the other gaming and the other things goes into the company. That's a separate concept to discuss in this video, in the other videos of the CMA, okay. Now let's talk about, now I hope you have cleared with under and the over applied overheads, okay. If you have any doubts, your doubts are most welcome, you can ask me, okay. Now let's talk about the journal entries that has to be passed when the actual or under applied overheads occurs. So basically when this over applied overheads occurs, definitely we have to distribute cost somewhere. Now the expenses has incurred, we cannot do nothing because this thing has to be prepared after the goods have been manufactured and the goods has been produced. After that these accounts are comes in front of our eyes. So now cost has been prepared, again the cost has been expensed in the accounting cycle, okay. Now we have to set this cost somewhere in our books of accounts. So basically what some companies do, they distribute cost under the COGS head okay, and under only the COGS head and the overhead head, and some companies distribute their costs under COGS, work in process inventory, finished goods inventory, overhead heads, and the factory overhead incurred head. I'll go in detail, okay, don't get confused with it. So basically, now why the company sets this cost under the COGS category, WIP or finished goods? Basically, whatever the manufacturing related expenses are, all the manufacturing related expenses are under the cost of goods sold, work in process inventory, and the finished goods inventory. So definitely, when the overheads has been under or the over applied, at that time also these costs have to be distributed in these heads only, in these cost categories only. Okay, so that is the major reason for this. So COGS means cost of goods sold, the actual the cost incurred while selling my product to the customers, that was cost of goods sold. So it's just a basic example. So for example, we have $100,000 overhead incurred in a year for my company. So I distributed some ratio like 40% towards COGS and 60% towards my overhead account of my company. And similarly, in another company, the overhead incurred was $100,000. Similarly, they distributed 20% towards COGS, 20% towards work in progress inventory, and 10% towards finished goods, and 50% towards the factory overhead applied account. Okay, now it depends upon the company policies how much cost they have to distribute under which head. So you just need to remember the adjustment entry. So these under and the overhead applied cost goes into the COGS account, work in process account, and the factory and the finished goods overhead account, and the overhead account definitely. Okay, just remember the concepts. And guys, please, if you found like the video is going too fast for some students, so please go into your YouTube settings and just low down the speed of the video. And do comment down below, how did you like the video? Did you like it? Did you get the proper explanation that you were expecting out from this video? Okay, do tell me in it. Okay, now the next topic is cost behavior and the cost objects for my company. Okay, so basically the cost behavior means how the costs behave at what level of output in my company, and similarly the part with the cost objects for my company also. Okay, so now let's like what can be the cost behavior. The cost under the cost behavior, the categories can be the fixed cost, the variable cost, the mixed cost. Okay, now you know somewhat, you have an idea about fixed and the variable cost. So fixed cost is basically the cost which do not change as per the level of output up to a certain point of time, up to a certain unit of time. And the variable cost is the cost which keeps on varying, because it is variable, it keeps on varying at any level of output. So if we are producing 500 units of output, then the variable cost will be varying as per the 500 units of output. But if we are manufacturing only 200 units of output, then the variable cost will be reducing to 200 units of output. So it depends upon the company, depends upon the output. But the fixed cost will remain the fixed at any number of output up until the time it is in the relevant range of the business. Now what is the relevant range? Relevant range is the range under which the company operates. Okay, so for example, if I have a manufacturing machinery that is producing 200 shoes within a day, and I got an order of 250 shoes to manufacture within a day, so what I am doing, I have to manufacture 50, I take up the contract, I have to manufacture 50 plus shoes plus 50 shoes while going outside the relevant range of my machinery. Okay, so at that time the fixed cost will vary. Up to the 200 units the fixed cost will remain same. Okay, but when I will go when I will cross my relevant range for my machinery, definitely there would be some extra wear and tear in the machinery, because that is a machine. If we will use more than its estimated amount, then definitely there would be some wear and tear. There can be some repair and maintenance of the machinery. So that adds some it will consume extra electricity. So that will add some extra cost to the machinery. So at that point of time, my fixed cost will rise up. And the variable cost is the variable cost will produce as many levels of output, the variable cost will be keeps on increasing. Okay, there are certain exemptions or there are certain assumptions or something in the fixed and the variable cost, but that is not to be discussed at this point of time. We'll further discuss into great detail into the next upcoming slides of this video. Okay, so I hope you have been cleared up with the cost behavior. Cost behavior means how the cost behave at what level of output, and relevant range is the range in which the company operates usually from its day-to-day operations of the business. Okay, let's go for next now. Cost. Okay, I have discussed the variable and the fixed cost. Now you all know the difference between variable and the fixed. Variable keeps on varying, fixed remains fixed at any level of output. Okay, so that's a total cost. Where's the cost? Okay, so that's a total cost for my company. Okay, that's a total cost for my business. Total cost is always is equal to fixed cost plus variable cost. That's a common thing to understand. Okay, it's not so much difficult. Total cost is always is equal to fixed cost plus variable cost. Okay, fixed cost plus variable cost. Okay, and in next slide I will tell you about the mixed cost, how the mixed cost is derived. Okay, I'll tell you further. Okay, no problem. So basically fixed costs are further of two types: discretionary cost and the committed cost. Discretionary cost is also known as managed cost or the budgeted fixed cost. Okay, and it is included or excluded from the budget. It depends upon the manager's decisions. Okay, so discretionary cost depends upon the manager discretionary power, depends upon the manager decisions. If the manager wants to add this cost into the budget, the manager will add. If the manager don't want, it can change. If the manager want to add a higher cost, it will add a higher cost. So it is in the hand of the managers of the company. That's why it is known as discretionary cost. Now what can be the examples of discretionary cost? These can be the advertising expenses. Some year the manager can go to the plenty amounts of advertisements, or some year the manager can reduce their level of advertisements. Okay, so it depends upon the advertisement cost of my company. Okay, so more the advertisement, more the cost will be charged. Less advertisement, less the cost will be charged. Okay, similarly the amount spent on the new joinees or the new people, those are hired for the internships, similarly more joinings will come, more expenses will be incurred. Less joinings will come, less expenses will be incurred. So that is a kind of fixed cost that incurs every year, but it is on a discretionary basis. Okay, it can rise up, it can low down, depend on the manager discretionary powers. Okay, let's talk about the committed cost now. Committed cost is the cost that has to be incurred. It will not ask the manager whether we have to incur or not. That has to be incurred. The best example to explain you for this is the depreciation expenses. The depreciation expenses for the machinery has to be incurred at 10% minimum by the company. They have to put in their accounts. If they will not put the depreciation expenses in their account, then the government will have sharp eye on them. Why they are not adding the depreciation expenses? Definitely there is a problem. They can have a tax raid on the company. Okay, so depreciation expenses is a committed cost that has to be incurred by the company every year on their assets, on their machineries, building, etc. Okay, now let's go for the step cost. All right, okay, now let's talk about the step cost for my company. So step cost are the fixed cost with very narrow relevant ranges for my company. Okay, I'll explain you in detail, don't worry. So step cost, just look towards this diagram up. Okay, so on this side we have a volume and this side we have the cost in dollars, and these are the steps on which the cost is getting incurred. Okay, so up to a relevant range, Okay, up to a relevant range, this step cost can be also termed as a fixed cost. But when I will go more than my relevant range, कहते हैं ना जब हम अपने बिजनेस को ज़रूरत से ज़्यादा अपनी मशीनरीज को ज़रूरत से ज़्यादा यूज़ करेंगे, जब हम अपनी मशीनरीज को ज़रूरत से ज़्यादा उन पे हम प्रेशर डालेंगे काम करने का, तो उस टाइम पे क्या होगा, देयर विल बी वेरी हाई अमाउंट ऑफ वेयर एंड टेयर ऑन द मशीनरी. ओके, देयर कैन बी द चांस ऑफ रिपेयर एंड मेंटेनेंस, देयर कैन बी द चांस ऑफ डैमेजेस टू द मशीनरी ऑल्सो. तो उस टाइम पे क्या होगा, आई विल बी गेटिंग आउट ऑफ माई रेलिवेंट रेंज बिकॉज आई एम मैनुफैक्चरिंग मोर एंड मोर प्रोडक्ट्स एंड दैट इज़ अगेंस्ट माई मशीनरीज कैपेबिलिटीज एंड द कैपेसिटीज. वी विल डिस्कस कैपेसिटीज इन द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड ऑफ दिस वीडियो. ओके, सो बेसिकली अ स्टेप कॉस्ट आर द फिक्स्ड कॉस्ट विद वेरी नैरो रेलिवेंट रेंजेस. ओके, अ स्टेप कॉस्ट इज अ फिक्स्ड कॉस्ट विद वेरी नैरो रेलिवेंट रेंजेस. सो बेसिकली इफ दिस इज द रेलिवेंट रेंज फॉर माई बिजनेस एंड दिस इज द स्टेप कॉस्ट, द मोर एंड मोर यूनिट्स आई विल प्रोड्यूस द मोर एक्सपेंसिस विल बी इनकर्ड ऑन द मशीनरी. डेफिनेटली द मोर एक्सपेंसिस द मोर हैवी द प्राइस ऑफ द पर यूनिट प्रोडक्ट विल बी चार्ज फ्रॉम द कस्टमर्स. ओके, सो अप टू अ रेलिवेंट रेंज अ स्टेप कॉस्ट इज ऑल्सो टर्म्ड एज अ फिक्स कॉस्ट. बट इफ माई बिजनेस विल गो अगेंस्ट इफ माई बिजनेस विल गो मोर देन द रेलिवेंट रेंज, सो एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम दिस स्टेप कॉस्ट कैन बी कन्वर्टेड इंटू अ सेमी वेरिएबल कॉस्ट. ओके, एट दैट पर्टिकुलर टाइम वेन आई विल गो आउट ऑफ माई रेलिवेंट रेंज, सो एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम दिस स्टेप कॉस्ट, ओके, कैन बी दिस स्टेप कॉस्ट और दिस फिक्स कॉस्ट कैन बी कन्वर्टेड इंटू सेमी वेरिएबल कॉस्ट बिकॉज एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम माई फिक्स कॉस्ट इज नॉट इन द पोजिशन ऑफ फिक्स कॉस्ट. माई फिक्स कॉस्ट हैज़ बिन कन्वर्टेड इंटू द वेरिएबल कॉस्ट ऑफ द कंपनी. And we will not completely say it as variable cost because we have to distinguish between the two terms. So we will say it as the semi-variable cost. And remember the key point, my friends, this semi-variable cost is also known as mixed cost also. Okay, so don't confuse these topics up. Just read this line. A step cost may be approximated as either a variable cost if there are many steps. Okay, either a variable cost if there are many steps and a large value in a range, or as a fixed cost if there are few steps and a small relevant range. Okay, so up to a particular point of time step cost ko hum fixed cost bolenge, but jab hum relevant range se baat jayenge, jab hum apni machinery ke limit se baat jayenge, to us time pe wo fixed cost bhi variable semi variable cost mein badal jati hai. Theek hai, उस सेमी वेरिएबल कॉस्ट को हम मिक्स कॉस्ट भी बोलेंगे. ओके, सो डोंट कंफ्यूज दिस टॉपिक सर. ओके, सी आई टोल्ड यू दिस इज द वेरिएबल कॉस्ट, दिस इज द फिक्स कॉस्ट एंड दिस इज द लाइक व्हेन वी कंबाइन ऑल दिस टू टुगेदर दिस विल टर्म इट एज द मिक्स कॉस्ट फॉर माई कंपनी. ओके, दिस विल टर्म इट एज द मिक्स कॉस्ट ऑफ माई कंपनी. दिस इज द सेम टोटल कॉस्ट इज इक्वल टू टोटल फिक्स कॉस्ट प्लस एवरेज वेरिएबल कॉस्ट पर यूनिट प्लस क्वान्टिटी ऑफ यूनिट्स प्रोड्यूस. So these two will be like total cost is equal to fixed cost plus variable cost. Okay, wait, let me write it again. Total cost is equal to fixed cost plus variable cost. Okay, now you can understand very clearly. Okay, it's the same thing. It's the same thing. Don't confuse with this and this. Okay, it's the same. Total cost is equal to fixed cost plus variable cost. That's the same. Don't confuse these things. Okay. So now you know about total cost. You know about mixed cost. Okay. Now under the cost category, we have the product cost and the period cost. Again, don't mix the two terms together. Product cost is the cost that has been directly traced to a product, that has been incurred directly to a product. It is recognized as that in particular time only when the product is manufactured. But the period cost is termed after the period has been over. Okay, period cost cannot be directly traced to a particular product, but they are given to a particular product after the period has been over. Okay, so product cost given to a particular product at that in particular time only when the manufacturing has been performed, period cost is designated or is given to a particular product at the end of the period, at the end of the time period, at the end of the year, at the end of the quarter, at the end of the month. It depends upon the company production budget. Okay, we don't have a hand in that. It depends upon the company's policies and the budgets. Okay, so what are the things which we can include in the product cost? Now you will understand more better. Product cost includes the direct material cost, direct labor cost, manufacturing overhead cost, and the period cost includes the selling expenses and the administrative cost for my company. Okay, so under the product cost we have the direct material cost, direct labor cost. Now direct material cost includes the raw materials which are directly traced to a product, labor which is directly traced to a product, overheads like electricity, rent, etc. Now these all things are also traced to a product. Okay, though these are indirect, but they are traced to the product as soon as the manufacturing has been over out. Okay, so these three terms are under the product cost, so they help in the products to manufacture. Period cost is the cost like the salaries given to the accountants, salaries given to the repair and maintenance department, salaries given to the supervisors, etc. Now all these kinds of things will come under the administrative cost category. And administrative cost, like salaries are given after the end of, at the end period, right? At the end of the month or the end of the quarter, salaries are given at that time. So that will be termed under this period cost category. And selling expenses can be the advertising expenses, like after the product has been manufactured, now the advertising has to be made. So that is also at the end of the period. So that's why selling expenses and the administrative cost. Administrative cost is also known as the manageable cost for a company. Okay, so selling expenses and the administrative cost are termed under the period cost category of my company. Okay, are termed under the period cost category of my company. Chalo. So product cost means direct material, direct labor, overheads, and the period cost means, like, which term at end of the period, that is selling expenses and the administrative cost for my company. Let's go next now. Okay, it's the last topic for this video, right? Okay, we have already like crossing the 30 minutes. Actually, I have a limit for 30 minutes to upload a video on the YouTube. Like my every video do terms from 10 to 30 minutes. Okay, so I don't like keep the students for longer and longer period of hours. Okay. Okay, now capacity is basically, now capacity is of two types. So you know about capacity. Capacity means like the amount of output that has to be produced in my company on day to day basis, or on the quarterly, on the monthly, or on the year basis. So capacity is like that, the amount of capacity, like the amount of output that has to be produced in the any conditions in which the company operates in. Okay, now capacity is further classified into the two categories, practical capacity and the theoretical capacity. So practical capacity means, the practical capacity includes the minimum wear and tear of the machinery. Okay, so like the number of errors can occur while manufacturing a product, the untraceable expenses can incur, okay, the damages to a machinery can incur, the employees can take a leave from the company, the employees can take a half day leave, the employees can take a full day leave, the employees can go for a full holiday vacation. But okay, so like all these kinds of factors are included under the practical capacity of the company. And on this basis, they set some limits. Okay, in this day, on the one day of our practical capacity working, we can manufacture 500 units. Okay, so like they have some like a freedom of manufacturing their products. But under theoretical capacity, the factors are like, there should be no breakage in the machinery, there should be no errors occurring in the machinery, there should be no employees going on the vacations, no employees should be taking a leave, there should be no emergency in the company. That is a theoretical capacity. Now theoretical capacity is practically not possible, there can be number of errors because the machine is working. After all, it's all a machinery. Okay, employees can go on a break. Employees can have some emergency. They can go on a break. They can have the vacations. They can enjoy their leaves. Okay, so theoretical capacity is not practically available. So it's just a concept to study in your books. So most of the companies don't follow the theoretical capacity concept. They all follow the practical capacity concept. Okay. Chalo. Now, thank you so much, guys. For today, I think the concept has been over. The next topic will be including about the cost drivers and the absorption variable costing and the this NRV method and the other like kind of accounting methods that will be used, the income statement preparation using absorption and the variable costing. So that will be the another part of the video I will be uploading soon on the YouTube. So please do watch. Till the time, do like, subscribe and comment on the videos. If you like the videos, please do like the videos. Okay, and if you have any doubts or something, do the number is available, the email ID is available in the description. Go through that and do comment on the videos, like how do you like the videos, did you find it helpful. Okay, so it will be also act as a motivating factor to me also. Okay. Thank you so much, guys.